First of all, I'd like to thank Jim and the organizers for inviting me to talk here. I've been listening carefully to the talk so far, and I wanted to start by saying that originally I wanted to start like David Nahari and tell you a little bit about our center and why it was set up in 2008, but I think I'm going to start by reacting more to what I've heard. One of the things I want to start with is that a standard problem in computer science is that if there is a room in which many people are talking, how do you come up with an algorithm so that you can identify each unique speaker and what they have said? And the reason I start with that example is that the story of water, in the way that we are discussing it here, is one of many, many voices. It's not a single voice. It's many, many problems. And as a result, it's a convoluted story. We are not able to make progress on any one of the elements because of the lack of distinction between these stories. With that in mind, I think what I'm going to do is, instead of trying to synthesize all the different threads into one and add to the convolution problem, pick one issue which has not been highlighted to a degree which I think is important so far. And that is an issue of sustainability, but from a perspective which looks backwards, like a historian, and forwards. And I'm going to do this in the 10 minutes that I have through a story rather than trying to preach on various things. The issue is one which relates poverty. So I'm glad to see here people who are concerned about that. It relates to food, and it relates to energy, and it relates to water. And it's global. And the sense in which this comes out is that if you look at the largest quantity of use of water, it goes towards agriculture globally. The poorer the nation or the community, the higher the percentage of water that goes towards that. Some of the stories we have learned, as in our group we have worked across the world, is that when you see the pictures of the women and children carrying water from distances on their heads, often, not as far away, there is someone extracting groundwater and putting it to agricultural use, but that is not domestic water somehow, even though many times it's of much higher quality. So this is interesting, because what it suggests is that the economic value of water sometimes is actually valued very highly, especially as the product comes out, not necessarily in terms of willingness to pay. This is an interesting sort of dichotomy, because if you come up with looking at a principle such as the human right to water, I think that human right to water should also say that that does not preclude you from having to pay for that right in terms of use. Unless we do that, the story that I'm going to tell you suggests that we are in big trouble. Okay, so the story works like this. It's in the water, energy, food, economics framework, and it starts with me being a 10-year-old living in India when the major famine of the 20th century took place. My recollection of that is spending day after day in lines looking for food at government ration shops and not getting it. And then every morning you line up again. You know, that situation doesn't happen in a country like India today. Remarkably, there's been a transition, but remarkably, that transition is now in danger. It's in danger in India, it's in danger in Pakistan, it's in danger in China and other places. The responses are different. What is happening in India today is that there is a relatively small part of the country that participated in the Green Revolution. The Green Revolution was sustained in this place through extraction of water, through extraction of groundwater. That groundwater now is dropping rapidly. The efficiency of water use is negligible. In part, this is because the government provided electricity. As soon as everybody was electrified, they were able to extract groundwater. Normally, this is a feedback process where as you go deeper with the groundwater, the cost of extraction increases and you have a signal to stop. In this case, because India is a democracy, the populist government decided water should be free, namely electricity should be free. So we now have a situation where the productivity is decreasing, the rate of extraction of groundwater is increasing. There are 3 to 4 crops a year planted by farmers because you need food. The population of the country when I was a kid was 400 million. Today it's 1.2 billion. You have to feed these people. So one crop goes to 3 crops. Okay, a simple math. So what do we see in the future? Where does the food for this that we come from. The efficiency of water application in agriculture is low. The global average water that goes towards agriculture is 70%. In India, it's 90%. Okay? The efficiency of water use is 10 to 15%. If I can bump that from 10 to 20, that's all I'm asking for. That's as much water as all other sectors use. Okay, remarkably, it turns out that because of the free electricity use, the reliability of the electric system degrades. Which means, if you're in industry, you're putting up your own diesel generator. Which means, you're paying 30 to 35 cents a kilowatt hour instead of 5 to 10 cents a kilowatt hour. Which means you're not getting economic development. Okay? This is one part of the story. The other part of the story goes to a state called Gujarat in India. Here, the groundwater levels are dropping 3 to 6 meters a year. They are not growing food, they are growing cash crops. Okay, so this is purely for economic sustenance of a large amount of the population that is in that sector. 3 to 6 feet a year in groundwater drop. They are pumping from 200 meters now. Yeah. Okay. What this maps into is that the cost of generating electricity that is given as pumping, free, is two times the income the farmer derives from it. You might as well just give this person cash. You know? So the water story with food, agriculture, and poverty takes remarkable turns. This is the dimension of the story in India. They do not currently have a strategy for how they are going to deal with it. They are finally waking up to the fact that systemic use of water needs to be brought under control. They don't know how much water is being used because none of it is metered. Okay, so this is an important thing. They don't know how much water is there because they don't have a systematic way of doing the mass balance. They're not charging for it. So these are, I think, macro level problems that have to be brought into play and solved. What is China doing? China has gone through a somewhat similar trajectory. They're doing two things. One is to divert a huge amount of the water from the south to the north. Not for agriculture, but for drinking purposes. The north is water short. They're solving that problem by undertaking agriculture in Africa and in South America. Okay. So we have taken something which is food security and emphasized that in India, emphasized that in China historically, and now what we are saying is we cannot achieve food security, we cannot achieve energy security, so we are going to exogenize some of these factors. The planet is finite, so this is not going to work in the long run. The good part of the story is that it's actually possible to increase water use efficiency in these sectors and achieve quite a bit. We've worked in many of these places and we have found